Planning and Zoning Commission. Bring to order. I'll start with the approval of the minutes with the commission.
Start the roll call.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Do you have the?
Roll call, please.
Becker.
Here.
Buckley. O'Flaherty.
Here.
Klein.
Here.
Doe. Wright.
Here.
Chair Maxwell.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Move to the approval of the minutes. If there are any comments, changes, or additions or deletions.
Approve the agenda first.
Oh, sorry. First time out. Second time out. Vote to approve the agenda.
So move.
Second.
Noted by Smith and Buckley.
Let's do a voice vote on that.
I'm sorry?
We can just do a voice vote. All those in favor?
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Same sign. Same sign opposed. Passed.
Motion passes, and we can do the minutes.
Move to approve the minute, or ask to approve the minutes for the last meeting. Any changes, additions, or deletions?
So move.
Moved by Mr. Klein.
Second.
Second by Smith. All in favor, say aye.
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 Same sign opposed. So moved. This is the portion where we come to public participation for anyone that would like to come to this podium and speak on anything that is not on the agenda. Please do so, and if you'd like to, state your name and address. Okay. If not, we'll move to new business. I'd like to open the public hearing in the public agenda for the first item. Community development, I'm sorry, staff report?
No, just read the hearing right off the new business here.
Public hearing petitioned by the DeKalb Community School District 428 for a special use permit to allow a private school to locate in the former Cheeseboro Elementary School located at 900 East Garden Street.
Yeah, we'll have the applicant get up first.
Thank you. My name is Tammy Carson. I'm the Director of Facility Operations for DeKalb School District. We do have some other members in the audience. Should there be any specific questions from our district, we have Jamie Craven, our superintendent, Christy Meyer, our Director of Student Services, and three representatives from Menta Group. That would be Beth, Rory, and Brian. So if we get anything specific in those areas, we can bring them forth. We have a school building that has been closed since 2011, Cheeseboro Elementary. And we've been using it as a storage facility for the district for furniture and equipment since that time. We are now in discussions with Menta Group, which is a therapeutic day school where many of our students attend. Currently, most of our students are attending in the Aurora facility, and they were looking to open up a site in DeKalb, and that would bring our DeKalb students back to the community rather than busing them to Aurora. In doing so, we looked at our facility, and it is a great fit for their program, a great fit for our students. And we would be looking at renovating that in a shared cost with Menta Group. We were looking to go out to bid and later this spring, with construction starting late summer. And then we would be they would be opening their program in January is the timeline. With this, they'd occupy about 80% of the building, and then the school district would still continue to occupy approximately 20%. That would be for some district offices, administrative offices, as well as retain some storage in the building for facility operations storage. In doing so, we would relocate our current furniture and equipment that we're storing in there to an off-site location temporarily until a permanent solution can be made. So at this point, we're looking for approval to get this special use permit to go through some of the slides that Mr. Olson put together. This is the location. It is on East Taylor. The address is actually East Garden, but the back parking lot is off of East Taylor Street. Most of it is connecting Garden and Taylor with a small stretch that does go the length of Garden, which is pretty much open land. another aerial view with some of the neighbors. The parking lot in the back, we would not be looking to make any changes to the outside of the parking lot, with the exception we would be, we are looking at bidding out and would be bringing forth at a later date, potentially a parking lot and a drop-off area off of Garden Street that would be on our property, so that we'd have the option of having onsite parking rather than street parking in the front of the building, because the front is off a garden. Buses and students and staff would come in and park off the back off of Taylor Street, and visitors would be using the Garden Street drop-off. I should also mention another group that we're looking to relocate to this location is the Barb Food Mart, which is the food pantry that is operated out of Huntley Middle School currently. Because we have a need to expand at Huntley Middle School into some of those spaces, we were able to find some space in this that the food mart would be looking to move into. This is a view of the back parking lot off of Taylor Street. And then that's the potential floor plan that we're drawing in regards to the renovations. Any questions?
At this time, I'd like to ask the city to make their report.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Staff report in your packet. Tammy did a good job of summarizing the request. The zoning there is actually residential, two-family residential. A special use is required for any private school or in that particular zoning district, which they've applied for, of course. They're describing the organization, the Menta Group, that wants to move in. It's a therapeutic day school. There's a good summary of the operations in your packet regarding the Menta Group, what they plan on doing. They indicated that the school district, that they're currently sending students to this organization, Aurora. We want to bring this facility out to DeKalb so the students can locate and go to this, have these facilities close to home. Again, the school, the background was built about in the mid-70s. There was a special use permit issued in 2003 by the city to do an addition on the southeast portion of the building. As mentioned, the former school has been closed since 2011. They've had the school district use it for storage purposes. So the Menta Group would like to take about 80% of it. The building, they'll be doing some interior renovations, some work on the roof. They also propose to do some with the parking lot, restripe that. They need some resurfacing, restriping, new signage put up, or maintaining existing signage, new signage for handicap, other directional signage. They also plan on doing some repairs, work on the sidewalks going around the two sides of the building also. So we're making those as conditions that those be done prior to final occupancy by the Menta Group. Also, they're going to be adding a trash dumpster to the school, and we'll be fully screening that per the requirements in the Unified Development Ordinance. So they're going to serve, proposing in their summary, about 60, 80 students in the facility. The hours of operation are noted there, and they're going to pretty much match what a typical elementary school when Cheeseboro was open, what they'd be doing in terms of regular September through June hours, and then some summer month hours also, not as long. There'll be about 25 Menta staff members in the building at one time during the operating hours. We'll have occasional evening activities, but nothing past 8 p.m. And as indicated, they anticipate starting the work this year and then open in January 2021. So with any special use, there's findings of fact. The first one is that they meet all the requirements of the underlying zoning district in the UDO, which they are. As I mentioned, they'll be restriping the parking lot, resurfacing that, repairing the signage per the UDO standards. It won't have any detrimental effect on the surrounding area. They're not expanding the footprint of the school building at all, doing some interior repairs, some exterior work too. Much of the surrounding areas, you can see from the aerial, is already developed. They have the DeKalb Park District Park to the east, surrounding residential. There is some two-family to the directly to the west of the location. All the utilities are in place, and finally, they're providing a needed service to the educational needs of the community, which will benefit the public health, safety, and general welfare of the city, which is important findings of fact in the UDO. We did get some citizen response and comments regarding the request. Those are provided in your packet. Just summarizing, we did receive a citizen response form from Robert Cook at 953 East Taylor, indicating his support. He wanted us to see more specifics. I did speak to Mr. Cook and answered some of his questions regarding the type of students that'll be there, the number, the hours, other questions that were in the summary. Answered those for him, and he seemed to be happy with the response. Also received a response form from Jose Juan Huerta, 802 Roosevelt Court, indicating his support for the request. Also received an email from Kathy Tiberi of 525 South 10th Street. She noted support of it, but had a concern about the amount of garbage that was in her yard when the Cheeseboro School was operating. So I did forward that on to the district. They indicated there'd be a trash dumpster will be located at the southwest portion of the building, will be fully screened per our UDO requirements, and that is a condition that we did add on to the motion. Also received today, and I have in front of you another citizen response form from Megan Jordan, 957 East Taylor Street, indicating her support for the special use request. So those are all provided to you and part of the public hearing. So there's a sample motion recommending approval based on the site plan Exhibit A, which is the site plan they provided. And Tammy went through the other aerials and views of the site for you. The two conditions, as noted, resurfacing the parking lot, restriping, putting up the appropriate signage, and replacing the, as needed, the sidewalks around the building, and also locating the trash recycling dumpster and screening that prior to occupancy by the Menta Group. Be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
At this point, I would like to open it up to the public for anyone that has any questions. Please, if you do, please step to the podium, state your name and address.
Robert Erickson, 915 East Garden Street, directly across from the baseball diamond. I don't have any particular problem with the school going in there. It'd be better than watching the school fall down as it is now. So it'd be great to have it improved. The only real concern a couple of us have are that they do indeed keep the bus traffic and as much pickup traffic as possible to the rear. When Cheeseboro was open, there was a tremendous problem with the buses all parking on Garden Street in front of the school and the park, part of the park area there. And the street is not wide enough, and if there's other private vehicles parked on the other side of the street, it was quite dangerous. Luckily, no children were ever killed, although I saw many close calls. And I see no reason why. We tried to discuss that before with the school district, but got nowhere on it, or the police department for that matter. In fact, they would come once in a while and check and then disappear. But if the bus pickup and the majority of parking could be kept to the back, that would be great. And I think you mentioned something about maybe cutting a loop or something in the, or a parking lot in the front that had been suggested in the past before, and I think that would be cure a good deal of the traffic problem there on Garden. Other than that, I have no objection to a school. I guess a curiosity question, why the school organization was sort of kept secret and not mentioned in the letter that was sent out to the residences in the area. There's no indication of to who it was. This is the first time we're finding out who the private school is.
Yeah, the notice did mention private school, and then at the bottom there was a link to the website that had the overview of the, and a full description of the mentor group there.
Yeah, didn't get a chance to. I do have just a sort of off-topic related question, looking at the lot lines for it. Did the land swap between the park district and the school district go through that they were proposing before? Is that why the L on Garden Street is?
That's the current ownership. I don't know if there was a swap. Maybe the school district, Tammy could.
There was not. That section of it was always owned by the school district. It's just the.
Oh, it was always owned by?
It was.
Never.
But the swap that was up for discussion at one point did not go through.
Oh, that's interesting, because in our talks with the Park District about the keeping up the baseball diamond, it was their baseball diamond, they said.
They have maintained that area for us, but it is not technically Park District property. It's always been school district.
The Park District then is going to continue to maintain the whole?
We haven't entered into further discussions on it. I'm sure it's something we can work out, but we have a very good relationship with the Park District. If need be, the school district will maintain, because we will be there maintaining the other grounds.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to address?
David Gersick. I live at 927 East Garden, two doors down from Bob. Following up on the comment from whoever it was on 10th Street about the trash, there did used to be a ton of that just blowing across from the school, so anything you can do about that would be really helpful. And also on the traffic plan, I was curious mostly about that, how you were going to handle that, because that whole street is no parking on the south side, but there were usually 40 or 50 cars parked there with people trying to pick up and drop off kids twice a day. Unpatrolled, unstopped, people wandering around in and out of traffic. It was chaos. So that if you could cut that in, I'd really like to see a plan for how that's going to work out. That would be good. And one other comment, your sidewalks are deteriorating. You might be able to fix that by getting people to stop driving on them. It's an almost daily occurrence that somebody leaves the parking lot trying to get out and drives up the sidewalk around the school and back to the parking lot. It has to be hard on them. Signs, barriers, something in the plan to stop that might be good for your sidewalks. But other than that, I'm generally in favor of the idea. It would be nice to see a school open again, so you know, sign me up. I like it. So thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? Okay. With that, I'd like to close the public hearing and open it to discussion for committee.
No.
Jerry?
Yes. What are the current number of students that are bused from here to the Aurora school?
If you could come up to the microphone, yeah. Yeah,
please.
Be better.
I am Christy Meyer. I am the Director of Student Services for DeKalb District 428. And currently, we have 36 students that we are busing to Aurora each day. We also see this as an opportunity for our neighboring districts who also have students who are going to Aurora. For example, I believe they Sycamore might have 8 students that are going to Aurora, so that they have more of a local option as well. So this isn't only for DeKalb District 428, it is for our surrounding districts.
So when you, in the report it had 60 to 80, you're anticipating some other districts having students there?
Yes, sir. We're anticipating other districts, but we're also looking at, besides Core Academy, which is managed by the Menta Group, we also have students in other therapeutic day programming throughout, for example, Streamwood and Belvedere, and we'd like to take a look at each student and their profile and if they would also gain from coming to the DeKalb location in order to bring them closer to home. Okay. So that's where those numbers, I would say when we look at our 36, as well as our students that we're looking to bring back from other therapeutic days, we get close to that 50 mark.
So when you talk about the other therapeutic days, there are DeKalb district students going to other
places?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Because they have better accommodations for them there?
Than in our school system?
Yes.
Okay, so what happens is sometimes due to whatever the students' needs are, we aren't able to fully serve them within our school setting.
Right.
And so we have to look for a more therapeutic setting, a private therapeutic setting. And so it really depends on, one, what the student's needs might be, and two, the availability of a spot. The Menta group can speak to that, that, you know, we're very hopeful when we call them to see when we have a student that needs that kind of therapeutic service, that they would be available. But there's many, many districts seeking those spots. That's why they're looking to open another location.
Okay. The I think Tammy mentioned 80% of the facility would be for the student use. Some would be for storage. And the food mart.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. So what percentage of this building is going to these other? How does it break down? To the storage and the food mart, and how much of that?
That's 20% of the building.
Yeah, how does that break down?
See what you're saying. Yeah. Tammy, food mart, maybe?
Of the 20%, I would say food mart would be occupying 12-13%. Probably another 5% will be for office space, and then the remaining would be some storage off of our receiving area.
All right. Is the 60 to 80 students, is that significantly lower than there were when Cheeseboro was functioning?
Yes, sir. Yes.
How many students were?
I would say between 280 and 300. 280 to 300.
Okay. All right. And
that is a typical size.
Yeah.
Mr. Wright, typical for a therapeutic day. They usually run in that 60 to 80.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, because of the specialized needs that the students have.
All right.
And the number of staff.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I did want to ask, a couple of gentlemen talked about bus traffic. Can you go over that again, the way is there a plan for that, you know, to keep it off of Garden?
The students that come to the program come in a variety of different ways of transportation. They could be bused, and Menta may want to speak of this more specifically on how they actually are transported, but the plan would be that they would come in off of the Garden Street entrance. The Taylor Street entrance,
okay.
Not the Garden. The Garden Street entrance would be more for visitors, or should there be parents coming for IEP meetings or those types, but not for the students and staff of the program.
Yeah. All right.
So yes, for all of our programs, we set up staging areas for our students where they would be dropped off and picked up, just to ensure that we are not obstructing any of the public streets.
I'm sorry, could you state your name, please?
I'm sorry, I'm Rory Conran, and I'm with the Menta Group.
Thank you.
So when you say staging areas, you mean the drop-off areas?
And because of our student population size, it's not that many vehicles that we could look at the parking lot, and we would have them drop off and pick up in that area.
All right.
May I ask quickly to that point, if you only have 80 students, I mean, what's the potential, what's the volume of buses you would even imagine? It can't be that many.
No, with 80 students, I would say we might run, and if we're using our vans, which are about 10 passenger vans, I mean, you might hit up to 10. So typically that's about what we see. And each individual kid is a little bit different on how they get transported. And that's a decision that's made through the IEP team and the district.
So the volume of traffic is going to be pretty low.
Yeah, it's minimal.
When with an 80 student capacity at this point and the size of the building, should you stretch to that point, is there capacity to extend beyond 80 students within the building, the structure of the building itself, or is that pretty much the upper limit of capacity?
From a building standpoint, if they were looking, they could potentially take over about the 15% of the 20% could be turned over to Menta should we come to a future agreement for that. from a building, we would then have to look for another location for the offices and food mart that we'd be putting in there.
How are you, within the building itself then, how are you isolating the three different components of occupancy?
The food mart is occupied after school on Thursday evenings, and it's in the front of the building where Menta would not be having classes. It is in their own secluded area. And then the facility and food service offices that we're looking to relocate would actually be where the old main office was at Cheeseboro, where the principal and the main office staff used to sit. And so we would be up at the front of the building there, and there would be times we would cross paths with them. We've had a lot of discussions. They share spaces now with other programs and other schools and have had no concerns with that whatsoever. It would strictly be adults from the district that would be in the building during the times then the school would be in session.
Thank you.
Is there, with concern to the, or with regard to the food pantry, is there a separate entrance that would not allow access to the rest of the building should they want to come in and or go out during the course of a weekend or something?
We do. They would enter and exit from the front door of the building off of Garden Street. The food mart would use that, their patrons. Okay. And from a standpoint of keeping them in their area, we've already spoken and put in a plan together with, we've already spoken and put a plan together with the food mart, so they would not be able to get into the majority of the school area except for an agreed upon shared classroom where they would have educational programs during the food mart times that they're open. Okay. So
yeah, and you are subdividing portions of it. The only reason I ask is because I know it's a very large open area, and so obviously you're constructing some walls to subdivide the area too.
Fortunately, the food mart area that is, that we're putting in, them into is an actual area that has closed off walls and doors. It's not in the open concept area in the core of the building.
Gotcha. I did have one other quick question. With regard to the Aurora facility, proportionally, is it about the same size in the amount of students?
No, our Aurora facility is about 24,000 square feet, and that's roughly 220 students currently. Okay. But that is our largest program organizationally. As we talked about earlier, we typically run on an average from, it's about 60 students per program.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you. Jersey?
No.
Steve, anything else? Ron, did you have any questions?
Yeah, I have no questions. I think it's appears to be a very logical and sensible use of the building. Mm-hmm. The petitioner.
Yep. Yeah. Just one follow-up. There was a comment by the school district. They may look in the future to have some an access off Garden or additional parking. So with this approval, the Exhibit A is the current layout aerial site plan. So with a change like that, if they were to come back with the proposed parking on Garden and a new access, they probably would have to do another public hearing, amend the special use, have another hearing, notify neighbors, and
sure,
have a review.
Okay. All right, if there aren't any further questions, I would like to look for someone to propose.
I make a motion.
Proposed by Mr. Wright. Second, please.
Let's have a motion read by Mr. Wright. Yeah.
Oh, and motion by Mr. Wright.
Based upon the submitted petition and testimony presented, I move that the Planning and Zoning Commission forward its finding of fact and recommend the City Council approval of the special use permit for a private therapeutic day school in the form of Cheeseboro Elementary School, located at 900 East Garden Street, as shown on the site plan received on January 29, 2020. Attached as Exhibit A, subject to the following conditions. One, the school district restripe the parking lot, resurface the sidewalks around the building, and repair or replace the parking lot signage, all in compliance with the Unified Development Ordinance prior to an occupancy permit being issued for the private therapeutic day school. And two, the placement of a trash / recycling dumpster on the site and permanently screened per the provisions of Article 7.11, screening of rubbish, garbage, and dumpster facilities of the Unified Development Ordinance prior to an occupancy permit being issued for the private therapeutic day school.
I second the motion.
Seconded by Mr. Klein. All in favor, say aye.
Let's have a roll call on this one, yeah.
Roll call, please.
Becker.
Yes.
Buckley. O'Flaherty.
Yes.
Klein.
Yes.
Doe. Wright.
Yes.
Chair Maxwell.
Yes.
Motion is passed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is petition by JLAR LLC, represented by Jim Mason, for a special use permit to allow a drive-through in association with a proposed coffee and ice cream shop to be located at 1406 Sycamore Road, Suite D.
We'll have the applicant come up.
Good evening, James Mason, local businessman. Where do we start?
Address, please.
What's the address of this facility?
I think you're looking for the address of your office.
120 North Annie Glidden Road is a corporate headquarters, yes, sir.
Thank you.
I'll just start out here. The entrepreneur that's going to run this, Francisco, that runs restaurants over in Sycamore and in Rockford, came to me and wanted to put in Mexican and regular ice cream, and I said, well, let's put in coffee and donuts and turn it into like a Starbucks. So I'm going to start a new company called Mace Bucks Coffee, and we're going to make a facility that was a doctor's office, 2,100 square feet, and the south side of the building has a driveway through, and it's perfect to put two drive-up windows. And that's what this POD is for. And if it's approved, I'll go ahead and bill it out, and we'll be open in probably 90 days. Any questions?
Not at this point. Would somebody like to make their presentation?
Yeah. So the report indicates, or goes through the background of the request, shows the area where the proposed drive-through, multi-tenant building, 1406 Sycamore Road. It's about 2,100 square feet. Any special use in the general commercial district is a special use, requires a special use permit. Other tenants in the building, there's four. Next door is the Ruby's Asian Market. They also have a CJ's Gaming, and then the feature restaurant at the end will be Los Panchos Experience Cafe and Suite A. The operator of the proposed ice cream and coffee shop that will have the drive-through, as Mr. Mason mentioned, Francisco and Leslie Morales, they'll be operating the Experience Cafe and Suite A at the end where Flappy's used to be. So it'll be the same owner. They also own Los Panchos restaurant in Sycamore. And working with the applicant on this, the main thing was trying to with the drive-through, we always try and look at traffic flow, circulation, to make sure that it works properly. It's a big site, but we had them, and it's shown on your site plan. There was a revision that's on your desk tonight that was revised per our comments to try and get the signage and pavement markings to help with the drive-through location. So the customers of the drive-through, of course, will enter from the south. So we made that one way from Oakwood Avenue. I'm trying to show my cursor here. So this is currently two-way. Make it one way as they come through the drive-through here. There's a menu board at the side of the building here. The first window you pay, and the second window you pick up like many other drive-throughs. They'll be striping this with a lane to clearly indicate it's a drive-through lane. Be one way here. So as traffic enters from the north, they can turn left. They won't be able to go straight. Of course, the traffic that will be, there's plenty of room there for traffic going around the drive-through lane to go through the rest of the shopping area. So traffic turning, going south, will turn left, and then they'll go south again, turn right, just to the west of the Secretary of State's office. This is going to be cleaned up right now. It's currently a two-way, but it is angled parking, as you can see. So this will be made one way this way. It's currently the pavement margins can't really see here, but it's, you can go both ways. There's no restrictions on it. So working with the applicant, they did revise a plan to kind of clean that area up and have a one-way into the, trying to show that here clearly, one-way into the driver's license place off of Oakwood here, and then they can go in front and then exit out, or they can go behind, of course. But with this angled parking, the two-way traffic doesn't work. People would have to kind of do a turn, odd turn to try and get into angled parking. So that's being cleared up and make a little bit easier traffic flow in that area as it relates to the drive-through. So with special uses, we can add conditions. We can try and look at the whole area to try and correct things in the past to bring it more in compliance with the UDO. With drive-throughs, the UDO to state, you have to have five stacking spaces in queue for the drive-through. So, and you want to make sure those five are not backing up onto a public road or interfering with the regular traffic flow of the shopping center. So with the drive-through here, they can accommodate five cars through there and not block access to the back here, which is more for employees. It doesn't back up into the street or anything. So there's plenty of room for the stacking of the drive-through with additional signage and pavement markings with the one-way. That will help the traffic flow and make sure that traffic gets in and out of the drive-through safely. So those are the big things we looked at when we took a look at this, make sure the, because the building obviously wasn't built for a drive-through, so that had to be changed, but the layout of it and make sure that the traffic does flow through there properly. I would note too, the special use permit last year, if you were on the commission, of course, with the 1500 with the indoor golf facility with Mr. Mason is completing now. With that special use, he did screen the dumpster on site and also added several bushes and trees along Sycamore Road, which were added last summer. Parking wise, so the nearest residential, I mean, that's right in the middle of the location. There's residence district boundaries about 300 feet away to the east. In terms of parking count, there's approximately 190 parking spaces in the whole shopping center there. As a reminder, this is all under one ownership, this whole area. They have shared parking easements, cross easements, sharing access and parking. And roughly, there's about 166 required parking spaces based generally on the square footage and the uses. So they do have enough parking on the location, even with the change of this. I did include a couple photos showing the, so this is looking south towards Oakwood Avenue. As you can see, there are about to be some modifications to, there's some landscaping, some bushes there. Had to be removed, some modification to the walk and a parking space. This is looking north from Oakwood Avenue entrance. Those steps have to be modified to accommodate the drive-through. Some improvements on the exterior of the building will have to be made. There actually is three parallel parking spaces there, not shown on the site plan, that were reserved for the former, there was a dentist's office there before. Those will, of course, be removed. So I have the findings of fact for special use in the staff report. The meeting all the requirements of the general commercial district and the UDO for the drive-through. Won't be detrimental to the surrounding area. It's commercial all around there. They're making the appropriate changes with the additions with the pavement markings and directional signage to direct the traffic through the drive-through and through the other areas in a safe manner. All the utilities facilities are already in place. And again, they'll be making the necessary changes to make it a safe operation for the motorists for the drive-through and the motorists for the rest of the businesses out there. We did receive one citizen response form from Sean Nicholas of Saren Restaurants, representing J.D. Wesley. They're the owners of the Wendy's across the street. They indicated they no objections. They did want to take a look at the plans. Once I said that to them, they did respond back, indicating they have no objections to the special use. And a copy of that email is in your packets. So we did get a revised plan after the packets were submitted out Friday, showing all the necessary changes. That's on your dais tonight in front of you. That date of that plan is February 14th, 2020, February 14th, 2020. So in the sample motion, you just have to plug in the date, February 14th, and recommends approval. Be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dan. Would anybody from the public like to come and speak to this issue? If not, I'll close the public hearing and open it up to comments from the council.
Yeah, I have a question, Jim. I just wonder if you can protect your entry with how busy the driver's license place is. Whenever you go there, they're packed and a lot of cars. What's going to keep them from blocking your driveway, and what's going to keep people using your driveway from blocking them? Or you don't see that as a problem?
The signs. You know, the people that go to the driver's license bureau are supposed to be able to read signs.
Maybe not.
I thought I got a chuckle out of that. We'll just manage it the best we can. I get, if it takes cones, we would put those out too.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think with the signs and the pavement mark, it should make it flow a little better. I mean, it's been that west side there with angle parking and the two-way traffic's been in place for a while, so it's just been a little inconvenient. I don't think there's been any major issues, but this kind of cleans it up a little bit better and around yeah, there. But they do get a lot of cars there, so they're not removing any parking. It's just a little bit better traffic flow there.
Yeah, that was my concern, was how, from my experience last year when I had to go and renew my license, I had to park essentially at Dr. Cloverdance's office to go to the DMV, and there was a lot of car traffic going willy-nilly, but if it's marked and...
I think it'll be better.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's a bit of a zoo, so... Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's my only concern, is that reasonable measures be taken in order to funnel. Mm-hmm. But.
Okay. Mr. Becker?
Yeah, I mean, I echo both of your comments. It's not uncommon. In fact, I'd say it's probably fairly regular that it occurs where people going into the Secretary of State's office end up parking over in that big parking lot and walking over. That's not your fault, of course. It's, you know, just not enough parking for the Secretary of State.
And how they're connected.
And how
excuse
they, yeah,
me.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I guess my biggest concern are, because of the way traffic is being redirected, people flying around the building to try to find some sort of spot and not being careful with the pedestrians who are inevitably going to park over in that parking lot to walk over when mm-hmm. there's overflow. I don't know what the solution is there. And adding an ice cream and coffee shop, I think it's just going to increase traffic. So I guess my biggest question is, at this point, the city has not made that one way yet, correct?
No, this is, if approved, the applicant would have to put in place these changes as shown.
Yeah, I don't know that I personally believe that taking that to a one way would help, but that's my perspective.
That's my problem.
Yeah. Well, it's not just your problem. It's a problem of the people going into the Secretary sure. of State's office, too. You know, as they're trying to find parking.
Yeah, none of the parking's being, you know, removed. This will remain angle. Everything in front will be the same. This will be there. You know, this parking behind the building will remain. They're going to lose. There's three parallel spaces now, which will be gone. So the parking really won't be affected that much, and hopefully the director. Yeah, there's going to be some additional traffic there. You know, I'm sure they want it successful, but I don't think this is going to be a McDonald's drive-through with 20 cars behind there. So
sure.
Hopefully they do, but
I think it's when you look at lot three, you know, you show parking back there, but there I've never seen that available for parking. Mm-hmm. There are always buses or city trucks
semis.
Or It's always something back there that keeps, if that could be opened up, you know, in a way that, you know.
Let me add to this. All this is designated for Secretary of State, all that. And they use about half of it. On the other side, it's all Comcast. But once we, you know, mark this, people actually pay attention to most of it. The other thing is that I don't think it's going to be as busy as McDonald's. So if you had 25 cars a day, we'd be happy.
Wow. Depends on how good the coffee and ice cream is.
Pardon me?
So it depends on how good the coffee and ice cream is.
Well, it's going to be good.
And if it's, you know, they're
I'm going in the coffee place. Business.
They do a nice job.
I can't make any money anywhere else, so I'm going to go in the coffee business.
There you go.
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The nobody commented from the DMV? I mean, there's no problem with that whatsoever.
Mr. Mason owns the building and leases it out, so.
There you go.
Yeah. Let me tell you about the DMV, Jerry. This is funny. We, because they're so efficient there, we get customers from Rockford, Waukegan, Aurora, Chicago, because those other driver's license bureaus, they're not as efficient. So what the Secretary of State's doing right here is the best. So that's why we get so much business there. In fact, I had to double up the air conditioners just to keep the rooms cool, you know. So we do get, but I know how to handle it. And on Monday, there's nobody there.
Right.
So Monday, Sunday, and Saturday, they're closed.
I was wondering about the lot behind them. They're used sometimes for, you know, truck parking and things like that.
Well, that's where they test. So they test there,
yeah,
yes.
Right there. So
that's all.
It's the motorcycle testing course, too.
Right.
Yeah. There's no changes proposed back there with this special use. So
no changes there on lot three on
so
that side.
Is that blocked off from the other side? You can drive right through there, can't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm. It's all open.
Worry about cars turning into their testing.
Nobody's ever complained.
Testing area.
In fact, would you go back to the site plan?
Right here is where they all come in. This is what we're seeing.
Right.
He's got it on here, right? Mm-hmm. And then if you don't want to go through there, we let them go all the way back.
You can cut through.
And 90% of the time, there's no trucks or buses.
All right.
So then what they'll do is they'll come around and then they'll go back out.
That way. Okay.
Signs are everything.
And the other thing is that the arrows coming, when you come out of the drive-through, you see an arrow one that turns. The other one next to that one right there, shouldn't it be going the other way? Because that's going to be two-way to that point where you have an arrow down at the bottom turning.
You know, Danny's got a good point. Are you following me there? He's got a good point. I wondered about that myself.
This one here?
Yeah. Because
I think it should go
well, here you can go turn left or straight. I think here we want to make sure that maybe it's a sign making sure that people can turn left here.
Yes.
Right.
So,
you think, Dan, would you agree?
Yeah, we can look at that area and make sure it's
all right. Yeah, that's all I had.
Thank you. Jim, I just had two quick questions. So as they come through, Dan, could you go back to the aerial view for a second? So where is the drive-through window going to be located on that building?
Right there.
Oh, okay. So
there's
they're going to have
yeah.
to.
You see
have
the five windows on there?
So they're going to have to hang out a hard left?
Yeah, when they leave.
Yeah, when they leave, those come out here and turn this way or go straight, okay. Either as they exit. So traffic up here that wants to go, that's going to other businesses coming this way, we're going to have them turn this way to exit out.
Okay. And then
some cars will just ignore that and kind of go through here. There's adequate width if that happens. I mean, you know, it's not, you know, there's a business here, but with the arrows and directional signage, most of the traffic will exit this way.
Okay. And then, Jim, what did you have in mind on for signage along Oakwood?
I haven't thought about it.
What
do we do for that?
We do have the one-way do not enter here, and then the entrance sign there.
Signage for arrows, yes, as we've stated here, but I haven't even thought about a sign for...
You're talking about signs for the business?
Yeah, it's just good, I mean, somebody's going to need to find it.
Well, if the marquee sign out on Sycamore Road, they'll have one of those.
Yeah, I just meant the drive-through aspect of it.
But you know what, thanks, these meetings are very truthful, we haven't even talked about that, we'll have to have a sign.
Yeah.
I mean, it almost seems like...
If I had a pointer, I would do it, but I don't...
Yeah.
I don't think there's any signs on Oakwood for any of the businesses.
We've got grass right there, we've got grass.
Okay.
That's right across from the two cabooses.
Yeah.
Yeah, a sign would be loud per our UDO on Oakwood.
Yeah.
Do you have the property that Bees is on too?
No.
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 I was just thinking that corner would be a nice spot to say that the drive-through starts there off of 23.
As I said, see, there's grass here, I think there's some grass here, it's mine. But it's not, we'll have to put it here. That is mine.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to think of ways that people could find it.
Right there.
I
haven't thought about it tonight. I do know.
Okay.
This is going to be spectacular, folks, because this Mexican coffee or Latino coffee, this or ice cream is phenomenal. And I'm just doing the coffee to augment it, to make it like Starbucks. Because a lot of people like to sit there, fiddle with their phones, and have coffee. Now you got ice cream, and we'll also sell donuts.
How many people will you accommodate inside the actual coffee ice cream?
It's 2,100 square feet, so I suppose, let me think about that. Probably 50, 60, maybe 50. Probably 45. Based on that square footed thing. We're taking down all the walls. If this goes through tonight, then I'm going to start demolition. Because the doctor's office had a lot of walls in there to do the operating rooms and stuff like that. So we have some work to do. And the same entrepreneur took over Bees, or Flappies. So Flappies, this gentleman has taken over both of them. He's also signed a contract with me. He's going to be running the liquor and the food service and the indoor golf place. So these people are making a big commitment into this business park. Big investment.
Good.
Anything else?
Any other questions?
After people have sat waiting for 2, 3, 4 hours to get their license renewed, this will be an ideal place for them to stop.
You know what? They will. They'll bring in the coffee, because that place is so packed sometimes. We've all had problems there, haven't we?
So. You might want a couple of concrete pylons out in front of it for the 16-year-olds.
All right. Well, advertising, I didn't think of it yet, so now I've just got a good idea here.
Okay. With that, roll call?
Motion first.
Motion first.
I'll make the motion if you want.
Motion, Mr. Klein.
Based upon the submitted petition and testimony presented, I move that the Planning and Zoning Commission forward its findings of fact and recommend to the City Council approval of a special use permit for a drive-through for a coffee and ice cream shop located at 1406 Sycamore Road, Suite D, per the site plan dated blank and labeled as Exhibit A.
The date of the plan would be February 14th. That's the one in front of you.
Pardon?
The date of the plan is February 14th. That's the one in front of you.
Okay.
Second?
Second.
Second by Jerry. Roll call.
Becker.
Yes.
Buckley, O'Flaherty.
Yes.
Klein.
Yes.
Doe, Wright.
Yes.
Chair Maxwell.
Yes.
Motion passed.
Thank you.
Are there any staff reports?
Update upcoming commission meeting. Our next meeting is March 4th. I'll be here. We have three hearings, and you've got emails on those. 110 Industrial Drive, a proposed towing operation, and with a storage yard is requested. A special use is requested. We'll also have the Raising Cane's on They have a special use request for a drive-through and outdoor eating area and the final plan approval. They are going in the, where Applebee's is, they'll be demoing the building and putting up a new restaurant with a drive-through. And also text amendments, a public hearing on text amendments regarding signage. So we did have a good discussion with the proposed amendments in front of the Committee of the Whole at the last Committee of the Whole meeting last week, kind of a discussion regarding the proposed changes. And then regarding the signs, they directed the staff to go ahead and set a public hearing in front of the Planning and Zoning Commission. We'll have that on March 4th. And
I'm very excited about that.
Yeah, I know you are. Good experience with signs, so we'll have that discussion. The summary and the specific changes were sent to the commission, so we'll go through those. We're talking to the Chamber of Commerce already and some other groups to give them information on what the changes are. So in general, they're basically, nothing's really more restrictive. It's content neutral. That's the main thing based on the U.S. Supreme Court case. So we'll have full explanation and go through a hearing on the March 4th regarding those. And then once the commission makes some recommendation, that will go back to council for final action. Okay. We also provided in front of you updated the members list. Mm-hmm. I have a contact information added. So if there's any corrections, let myself or Aaron know and we'll get those corrected and back to you. Thanks. That's all I have.
To Raising Cane's, do they have a theoretical completion date on the project?
They haven't mentioned that at this time, what the schedule is, but we'll have that information at the hearing. A more specific time frame in terms of construction and opening.
Okay. Anything to report from the commission?
Nope.
All right. With that, I'd ask for a motion to adjourn.
Second.
So moved. She wants out bad.
Let her move.
So moved by Trish. Second?
Second.
Second by Jerry. With that, I adjourn. Good night and good luck.